Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Surviving the Emotional Roller Coaster: DBT Skills to Help Teens Manage Emotions by Sheri Van Dijk, MSW, narrated by Suzie Althens. Introduction. If this book has caught your eye, chances are you know all too well about the emotional roller coaster, and you know that it's not a fun ride. In fact, it can be quite painful and scary, not in a good way, and can lead to a lot of other difficulties in your life, including mood problems like depression and anxiety, or complications in relationships. In turn, these issues can lead to problematic behaviors like self-harm, substance abuse, eating disorders, or aggression toward others. If any of these things sound familiar, this book is for you. It will help you survive the roller coaster and teach you skills to help you manage your emotions so that you're in control of your life, rather than just being a passenger along for the ride. Of course, the skills in this book can also help you not climb aboard the roller coaster to begin with. Emotional pain. Typical or overwhelming? Unfortunately, emotional pain is part of life. There's no avoiding it. Someone leaves us and we feel hurt or afraid. We don't get something we really want, and we feel sad or angry. Someone dies and we feel grief, loss, and loneliness. Most of us understand that these experiences are normal, that the hurt, disappointment, anger, sadness, and so on are unavoidable. Most people know that emotional pain is just that, painful. But like all pain, it will pass. Most people can understand why they feel the way they do, and so they can allow themselves to experience whatever they're feeling and gradually move on. For some, emotional pain is overwhelming and all-consuming. It is triggered by things other people wouldn't typically react to, and is so intense that they can't even think straight. Their emotions feel intolerable and unbearable, as if the pain will go on forever. Their emotional reaction is higher than what would typically be seen as warranted by the situation, and it takes them longer to come back down from that intense emotion to their usual selves. Understanding their emotions is unthinkable, and all they want to do is avoid the experience. These people have emotion dysregulation. What causes emotion dysregulation? Research continues in the field of mental health, and while there are theories about why mental illness develops, the bottom line is that we still don't really understand why some people develop mental health problems and others don't. But in dialectical behavior therapy, the treatment I use and will soon explain more about, the biosocial theory explains the development of emotion regulation problems as stemming from two things: biology and environment. Biology. According to the biosocial theory, some people are born with a higher likelihood of developing emotion regulation problems. Genetics is one reason people might be born this way. Just as I was born with hazel eyes, some people are born more sensitive than others. A second reason is that a traumatic experience can affect the human brain in such a way as to make a person more emotionally vulnerable. And a third reason is mental illness. A person who has a mental health problem, such as a mood or anxiety disorder, especially if it's not well managed by available treatments, will have more problems regulating emotions. Environment. The second part to this theory is the environment a person grows up in. It's important to understand that someone could be born more highly sensitive and not go on to develop problems in life, and be able to manage emotions relatively well. But according to the biosocial theory, when you put a highly sensitive person in an environment that is pervasively invalidating, problems will arise. A pervasively invalidating environment is one in which a person regularly receives the message that there's something wrong or inaccurate about her internal experience. For example, she might be told that she shouldn't feel the way she's feeling, or given the message that her opinions or beliefs are wrong. Perhaps she's punished for her feeling, or her feeling is ignored. Most people experience this kind of invalidation at times. Unfortunately, we don't always feel understood by others. The key here is that the invalidation is happening regularly. The other piece to remember is that many people might experience this kind of invalidation on a regular basis. But it's the combination of being a highly sensitive person and being in this kind of environment that will fairly inevitably lead to problems with emotion regulation. However, often people are invalidating without meaning to be. Your mom doesn't understand why you're so angry with yourself about the B you got on your report card. And the message you get from her is that you shouldn't feel this way. Or your best friend tells you that she's tired of having to put up with your explosions of anger and needs a break from you. Or your parents make you go to their work holiday party and then get angry with you when you're so anxious that you feel sick to your stomach and they have to leave the party early. You can see that in these situations, people probably aren't trying to be hurtful. They simply can't understand your emotional reaction, even though they might be trying to. Finally, I want to point out that, for the most part, we're not looking to blame anyone here. Sometimes there is blame to be placed. No one should be sexually, physically, emotionally, or verbally abused or neglected. If this is happening to you, I hope you'll listen to these words and understand that this situation is not acceptable. Please seek help. Talk to a family member, a teacher, a religious leader, a friend's parent, or someone else you feel you can trust, and let that person know what's happening so he or she can help you get out of your abusive environment. So this theory isn't about placing blame. It's just about helping you see why you are the way you are. This recognition can help you stop blaming yourself, because you didn't put yourself in this position. It's a combination of your genetics and your environment. Effects of emotion dysregulation. If you're relating to what I've described as emotion dysregulation, you already know what kinds of problems it causes in your life. But let's take stock of a few situations connected to difficulties managing your emotions, ones that you might be able to identify with. Not knowing who you are. If you're a highly sensitive person growing up in an invalidating environment, you may have gotten so used to being invalidated that you actually start to do it to yourself. In other words, you tell yourself you shouldn't be feeling the way you are. Or perhaps you look to the people around you to see how you should be feeling. When you do this often enough, you may actually stop being aware of the emotions you feel and the beliefs and opinions you hold. You're so busy trying to not be invalidated by others that you put your true self aside and try to be what others want you to be, or at least who you think they want you to be. In the end, you don't really know who this person you call me is. Problems in relationships. If you're highly sensitive, it's often very difficult for others to understand why you react to things the way you do. Let's face it, it's probably often difficult for you to understand why you react to things the way you do. Even when people are trying to understand and clearly still don't get where you're coming from, you're left feeling different, like you don't belong or fit in. So you might feel not only lonely, but also angry at others for not understanding you. How many times have you gotten so angry at another person that either you exploded at her and ended the relationship yourself, or she ended the relationship because of the way you treated her? Often, people with emotion regulation problems lose relationships because their emotions get in the way. Unhealthy or destructive behaviors. When people don't know how to manage emotions, they sometimes end up turning to unhealthy or even destructive behaviors in an attempt to cope. This can result in a number of problem behaviors, including, but not limited to, the following: using or abusing drugs and alcohol, escaping by gaming or gambling, turning to disordered eating, such as overeating, binging, or refusing to eat, self-harm, for example, cutting yourself, engaging in dangerous sexual practices, like having unprotected sex, or having sex with multiple partners, or thinking about, or engaging in, suicidal behaviors. Because you haven't yet learned what to do with intense emotions, and because your emotions get so intense much of the time, it makes sense you'd turn to these problem behaviors. And of course, we don't want you to continue with these behaviors, which can have so many negative consequences. This is where dialectical behavior therapy comes in. What is dialectical behavior therapy? Dialectical behavior therapy, DBT, a treatment developed by psychologist Marcia Linehan, teaches people skills to help them manage their emotions more effectively, so that they're happier and healthier, and so that their lives are closer to the way they'd like them to be. These DBT skills are separated into four groups. Mindfulness skills. Mindfulness skills have you practicing staying in the present moment, as opposed to living in the past or the future, and being more accepting of your present experience, rather than judging everything, which increases your painful emotions. These skills will help you get to know yourself better, as you'll be paying more attention to your internal experience and accepting it rather than invalidating it, and also help you reduce the amount of emotional pain you're experiencing on a daily basis. Distress tolerance skills. Distress tolerance skills are geared toward helping you get through crisis situations without making things worse by engaging in some of the problem behaviors mentioned earlier. Interpersonal effectiveness skills. Interpersonal effectiveness is about how to be more effective in the relationships in your life and with people in a more general sense. When you can increase your effectiveness in this area and improve your relationships, you'll often find that it's easier to deal with emotions as they arise. Emotion regulation skills. Emotion regulation skills help you learn to identify your emotions more effectively and to be more accepting of those emotions, recognizing that although they're often painful or uncomfortable, they serve a purpose and you need them. Sometimes these skills will help you reduce the intensity of an emotion, and sometimes they will help you change an emotion. But the overall theme of these skills is working on accepting your emotional experience and learning to bear the pain more skillfully, to tolerate the experience instead of trying to get rid of it. While emotion regulation skills are centered to what you're trying to accomplish, I left them until last because, really, all the skills in this book are going to help you manage your emotions more effectively. When you're living in the present moment and are more accepting, you'll have fewer and less intense emotions, making them easier to manage. When you're dealing with crisis situations more effectively, you'll feel better about yourself and will have more support from the people in your life, making emotions easier to manage. And when you're being more effective in your relationships, they will go more smoothly and will lead to less drama in your life, making emotions easier to manage. Hopefully, you're beginning to see that these skills are really going to help. But in order for you to get the most out of the skills, we need to figure out how you can get the most out of this book. Your next steps. If you have absolutely no intention of working to make changes in your life, save yourself some time and put this book back on the shelf. Like most other therapies, DBT is not about just picking up a book and hoping for the best. You can't even expect that if you listen to this book and do a bit of practice for a while, things will get better. Nope. This treatment is about making life changes. If you're willing to take the time to listen to this book and put in the work to practice what you're going to learn here, I guarantee that you'll see a positive change, even if it's just a tiny one at first. And the longer you practice, the better things will get. Let me tell you a story. As a teenager, Marcia Linehan was hospitalized for over 2 years because of mental illness. She would cut herself, burn herself, and pound her head against the floor and the walls. She had borderline personality disorder. As an adult, Dr. Linehan created DBT out of the skills, tools, and techniques she had learned to heal herself. So don't you dare think you can't do this. things may be really, really difficult for you right now, and you can make them better. I really hope that you're still with me and that you can have the courage that Dr. Linehan had to keep going with this book and start learning. Chapter 1. Mindfulness. Waking up to your life. You might be thinking, waking up? I'm already awake. You might be wondering how on earth you could go through life not awake. But the truth is that many people do. They go through life not fully aware of what's happening in the present moment, not fully aware of what they're thinking or feeling, or even how they're behaving. That's what this chapter is about. You're going to learn about a technique called mindfulness, which is going to help you become more aware of yourself, and which, over time, will help you wake up to your life. By the way, you may be thinking your problem is that you're already too awake, that you're too aware of your emotions, for example, and this is what makes them so painful. If this is the case, I suggest that you still need to work on waking up to the world around you. You'll learn skills to help with both of these problems throughout this book. What is mindfulness? Mindfulness is the core skill in DBT, precisely because it helps you wake up to your life. You can't change something until you first become aware of, or wake up to, what the reality is, of yourself, of your reactions to others, of the effect you have on others, and what's going on around you, and so on. Mindfulness is about doing one thing at a time, in the present moment, with your full attention and with acceptance. So think of this skill as having two parts. First, focusing on the one task or activity you're doing in the here and now, in just this one moment. And second, accepting whatever you happen to find in this moment. Focusing on the present moment. How often do you find yourself thinking about anything but what you're doing in the present? Maybe you're doing your homework, and instead of really focusing on your assignment, you're thinking about your plans for this weekend, or the fight you had with your parents, or what you'll buy your girlfriend for your upcoming anniversary, or anything else. You might be partly thinking about what you're doing, but your full attention isn't in the present. It's everywhere else. Sound familiar? Or maybe you're walking home from school, and instead of focusing on the walk and on the environment around you, you're thinking about all the homework you have to do later, or the college applications you have to fill out, or how hard the SATs are going to be. Again, you're not focusing on the one thing you're doing right now, walking. Instead, your mind is wandering to many other things. When you're being mindful, you bring your attention back over and over again to what you're doing in this moment. So when you're doing your homework and your attention wanders to your plans for this weekend, you notice that you've wandered and you bring your attention back. Each time you wander, you do your best to notice it and continue to bring your attention back to whatever you're doing in this moment. Of course, some things are easier to focus on than others. You might not find that your mind wanders much when you're watching your favorite TV show, reading a really good book, or playing your guitar. Some things will hold your attention more easily, just as some things will be really difficult for you to stay focused on, like maybe your homework. Regardless of how difficult or easy it is, though, it will be to your benefit to keep bringing your attention back to just this moment. We'll look more at the why momentarily. First, let's spend some time on the second part to this skill, acceptance. Accepting the present moment. Have you ever noticed how judgmental you are? And I don't mean that as a judgment. For most of us, it's just a fact. We are judgmental creatures. So that makes this part of mindfulness pretty tough. And in fact, it's so difficult that we're going to address this as a skill all on its own in Chapter 4. For now, though, you need to have a bit of an idea of how to practice acceptance as part of mindfulness. Let's go back to some of our previous examples. Let's say you're working on your homework assignment. and your little sister is making a whole lot of noise in the next room. Chances are, you're judging her. What's the matter with her? Doesn't she know I'm working? Or, she's so annoying, she shouldn't be so loud. Or, Mom or Dad should be telling her to be quiet. These are all judgments. With mindfulness, the idea is that you're focusing on what you're doing in this moment, and you're practicing being accepting of whatever is in the moment. Whether it's noise or other outside distractions, or your own thoughts, emotions, or physical sensations, you practice being non-judgmental. So, with your sister, acceptance might look something like this. She's being really loud. I'm distracted by the noise. Or, it's hard for me to concentrate when my sister's making so much noise. No judgments. You're just sticking to the facts. Again, we'll come back to this idea later. So don't worry if it doesn't make perfect sense just yet. Now, let's look at why I'm teaching you this skill and how it's going to help you in the long run. How mindfulness will help you survive the emotional roller coaster. Once you start practicing mindfulness, you'll find that the world will no longer be passing you by, and you'll be more aware of yourself, the thoughts you're thinking, the physical sensations in your body, the emotions you're feeling. You'll also be more aware of what's going on around you. You'll be participating, involved, and engaged in life. I'm going to break this down a little further so you'll really understand some of the many ways that mindfulness will be helpful. Reducing emotional pain. Do you think you spend a lot of time thinking about the past? It might be the distant past, things you've done or things that happened to you. Or it might be the more recent past, the argument you had with your parents the other day, or the grade you got on an exam. If you do spend a lot of time in the past, think for a moment about the emotions that tend to come up when you're there. Anger? Resentment? Frustration? Regret? Sadness? Sometimes you might find that you go to pleasant memories, like the fun you had with your friends last weekend, or when you were on vacation with your family over the summer. But for the most part, we tend not to go to happy places. Instead, we go to the painful memories. On the flip side, do you think you spend a lot of time thinking about the future? Worrying about whether you'll get into the college you want to go to? Feeling nervous about whether the girl you like will say yes if you ask her to the prom? Feeling anxious about making a fool of yourself if you go to the big party this weekend? And so on. Does this sound like you? Again, sometimes when we think of the future, we have pleasant emotions. Maybe you daydream about the trip to Costa Rica that's booked for January. Or you think about how great it's going to be when you graduate from high school and go to college. But most of the time, instead of thinking about the pleasant things, we're focusing on the negative, and this generates anxiety and worry. Hopefully, you can see the theme here. When you're not living in the present moment, there's more emotional pain. Of course, the present isn't always pleasant either. But if you're being more mindful, even when there's pain in the present, there's still less pain, because you're dealing only with the pain of the present, rather than the pain of the present, past, and future, all at the same time. Acceptance, the other part of mindfulness, also reduces the amount of emotional pain in your life. Again, as you'll see when we discuss this further in Chapter 4, judgments actually increase your emotional pain. So when you're being more mindful, you're more accepting, which means less pain. Increasing positive emotions. So far, we've been focusing on how mindfulness will help reduce painful emotions. But just as important, when you're being more mindful and waking up to your life, you'll be in the present moment more often to notice when positive things are happening. Picture this. You're at your prom. You asked the girl you like to go with you, and she said yes. But now, she's socializing with other people instead of just sitting with you. So you start to worry that she doesn't really like you. Maybe she agreed to come with you only because no one else asked her. You might start to worry, for example, that she's going to ditch you and you're going to look like an idiot. What happens in this scenario? Well, you probably aren't having a very good time. You might miss out on some good music because you're so caught up in your thoughts that you don't even notice what they're playing. You're probably missing out on some good times with your friends. Maybe you would normally dance, but you feel too anxious to get yourself moving, so you stay in your chair, which, of course, might have other consequences. Maybe your date would have come to dance with you if you'd gotten up, but you missed out on that opportunity because you were too caught up in your own worries. As difficult as it can be at times, when you can be mindful and focus on the present moment, you'll find that you notice the positives more. So if you kept turning your attention away from those worry thoughts, you might have heard someone at your table talking about how much he loves motorcycles, and you would have had a great conversation about bikes, which is one of your passions. Or you would have heard the joke that one of your friends told, which might have made you smile for a moment. Or you would have enjoyed the music more. There are often small positive experiences that take place around you that you probably miss out on because you're so caught up in your thoughts. This is what waking up to your life is about. Feeling calm and relaxed. Mindfulness can sometimes help you feel more relaxed and calm. But while this can be a beneficial side effect, it isn't actually the goal of mindfulness. The only goals of mindfulness are to be in the present moment and to be more accepting. And sometimes you might be practicing mindfulness and there's no way you're going to feel relaxed and calm. Let's say you have to do a presentation in class and public speaking makes you anxious. You could practice mindfulness, noticing that your heart is pounding and your palms are sweaty, noticing that you're having worry thoughts about making a fool of yourself or that you're going to forget your speech. You're focusing on the present moment, you're accepting it, and there's still no way you'll feel relaxed in that moment. The alternative, of course, not practicing mindfulness, often increases the painful emotions you're experiencing because you continue to think the worst about what might happen and because you're not accepting the experience but fighting it instead, which increases your emotional pain. So mindfulness is not about relaxation. But think about it. When you're in the present moment more often, instead of caught up in thoughts about everything in your head, you'll probably feel less overwhelmed. When you're accepting your experience instead of judging it and fighting it, you'll probably feel more at peace. When you're doing one activity at a time instead of three, you're going to be less scattered and more focused. The other part to this is that often the activities you choose to do mindfully are activities that help you feel calm and relaxed. For example, reading a book, watching TV, petting your dog, lying in the bathtub, taking a walk, or sitting outside. Increasing self-control. I've already mentioned that when you're being mindful, you're more aware of your thoughts, physical sensations, and emotions. When you can increase your awareness of something, you open up more choices for yourself. Again, you wake up to your life. So often people go through life on automatic pilot, just allowing thoughts and emotions to take them along for the ride. And they do this because they've never really learned that they can take control, that they can be in the driver's seat and direct where they want to go and what they want to think about. When you're living your life more mindfully and you're more aware of what's going on inside of you, you can choose whether you want to continue down that road. So when you're sitting at a prom watching your date mingle and you notice your thoughts start to turn in the painful direction of worry and anxiety, you now have a choice. Do you allow your thoughts to continue down that path? Or do you get up and do something to prevent this? Like maybe grab your date and take her to the dance floor? Improving concentration and memory. People often have difficulty concentrating, especially if there's an additional problem like attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, or even something like depression or anxiety. The skill of mindfulness has you practicing concentration. Bringing your attention back to the present, often over and over again, exercises the concentration muscles in your brain. Over time, your ability to focus will improve. When you're more able to focus on something, you'll have a better memory for it later. Have you ever walked home from school and not had a memory of at least some of the walk? Nowadays, with our dependence on smartphones, this kind of thing happens a lot. Your mom pokes her head into your bedroom and is having a conversation with you. You're half listening, but at the same time, you're texting your friend or browsing your Facebook newsfeed. Do you really remember the conversation you just had with your mom? Probably not, because you weren't really focusing on it. When your attention is divided, you won't have a good memory for what you've been doing. If you're practicing mindfulness, you're intentionally doing just one thing in the moment. So when your mom wants to talk to you, you put your phone down, or you ask her to wait a second while you finish sending your text, and then you turn your full attention to the conversation. When you're concentrating on just that one thing, you're going to remember it later. So mindfulness will also help improve your memory. Finding balance. Since the goal of this book is to help you survive the emotional roller coaster, finding balance probably sounds like a pretty good idea, right? Mindfulness helps us develop something called equanimity or balance, basically an evenness or stability in our state of mind, even when situations are causing us stress or other emotional pain. This doesn't mean that we don't react to things. It means that we don't let our reactions overtake us. In other words, we still feel emotions when situations arise, but we are able to access our inner wisdom and view the situation objectively, which helps us prevent ourselves from being overcome by the emotion and acting in ways we later regret. When you're practicing mindfulness regularly, you develop this sense of balance, so that even when life becomes painful, you maintain the ability to choose how to respond, rather than simply reacting from your emotions. Hopefully by now, you're seeing the many ways in which mindfulness can be helpful for you. So let's look at how exactly to practice mindfulness. How to practice mindfulness. First and foremost, it's important to remember that you can do absolutely anything mindfully. You can breathe, eat, have conversations with people, do your homework, shower, get dressed. The list is literally endless. And it's also important to recognize that the expectation is not that you practice mindfulness 24/7. While the goal is to live your life more mindfully, constantly being mindful isn't realistic. And we also know that allowing our minds to float and daydream increases creativity, which, of course, we don't want to get in the way of. Many of the skills you'll learn about in this book are about finding balance, and mindfulness is no different. You'll want to practice regularly so that this skill is accessible when you want it and need it. But don't pressure yourself to do it constantly. Rather, think of yourself as setting out on a path. You're never going to get to the end of the path, and that's not the point. The point is the journey, and that is mindfulness. 4 steps to mindfulness. So far, we've talked about many of the things you can do mindfully and the benefits of practicing, and we've looked at how not being mindful keeps you stuck on the emotional roller coaster. To make things easier, let's break mindfulness down into steps so you can see exactly how you can bring mindfulness to anything in your life. 1. Pick an activity. Remember, you can do anything mindfully. So pick an activity to focus on and bring your intention to that activity. If you're going to read, you may decide to read one page mindfully. If you're walking your dog, you might choose to walk mindfully from your front door to the end of the street. 2. Pay attention. Bring your attention to doing that one activity in the present moment. While you read, just focus on the words you're reading and become involved in the story. While you walk, you might notice how it feels to walk physically, such as the feeling of your feet on the sidewalk. Or you might choose to notice the environment around you. For example, a squirrel that runs across the road, or the trees at the side of the road. 3. Notice when you wander. Our brains generate thousands of thoughts every day, So it's almost impossible for your mind not to wander. Notice this. Acknowledge it. 4. Come back to the present. Bring your attention back to the activity you're doing in the here and now, without judging. This means that you don't judge yourself for wandering and that you don't judge whatever else happens to come into your awareness. For example, an emotion that arises within you, a certain thought that comes to mind, or something you experience with your senses. Whatever you happen to notice, just observe it instead of judging it. And then continue doing steps 3 and 4 over and over and over again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.